Hello students, today I am going to start chapter 2 in our hornbill. We are not afraid to die if we can all be together. We are not afraid to die if we can all be together. Written by Gordon Cook and Alan East. Okay, so written by Gordon Cook and Alan East. Okay, so let's start the beautiful chapter. It's a beautiful story of a family. So before proceeding, so let me explain the title. So title is very clear. It's a statement of a family, and family states that they are not afraid to die if they can all be together. So the title suggests that they were doing something adventurous in which they had to use this statement. Okay, so let us begin the beautiful chapter. Before beginning the chapter, let me introduce the chapter first. So this chapter is written by Gordon Cook and Alan East. The story, is about a 37-year-old businessman who is the narrator of the story. In this story, the narrator is a businessman of about 37 years. He has a wife named Mary and two children. Jonathan is it 6 and Suzanne is it 7. So in this chapter, the businessman is a 37-year-old man, and he has a wife named Mary and one son whose name is Jonathan and a daughter whose name is Suzanne. Okay, he and his wife both dream of a voyage around the world on their ship Wave Walker, which is a 23-meter long, 30-ton wooden hull, just like that of the famous Captain Cook. So the narrator as well as his wife, they were dreaming of a sea voyage around the world on their ship, and the name of the ship is Wave Walker, and the ship Wave Walker is 30 meter long and 30 ton wooden hull, just like that. And the same journey was completed by famous Captain James Cook. So now in this chapter, the narrator as well as his wife and children wanted to repeat that journey around the world. The whole family started sailing from Plymouth, England on July 1976. The initial phase of the 3-year-long journey was from south to Cape Town. It was pleasant while heading east, along with two newly hired crewmen. Strong waves hit them and their survival became a question. The story tells us about how they fought each day and survived till the end. Okay, so now let us begin the story, the beautiful story. The first paragraph of the story of the chapter. In July 1976, my wife Mary, son Jonathan, and daughter Suzanne, son Jonathan 6, daughter Suzanne 7, and I set sail from Plymouth, England to duplicate the round the world voyage, that is a long journey by sea or space, made 200 years earlier by Captain James Cook. For the longest time, Mary and I, a 37-year-old businessman, had dreamed of sailing in the wake of the famous explorer. And for the past 16 years, we had spent all our leisure time, all our free time, honing means sharpening, improving our seafaring, that is, traveling by sea, seafaring skills in British waters. Our board Wave Walker, a 23-meter, 30-ton wooden hulled beauty, had been professionally built, and we had spent months fitting it out and testing it in the roughest weather we could find. So in the first paragraph, the narrator tells us that he was 37 years old businessman, along with his wife Mary and two children, Jonathan is 6 and Suzanne is 7. His sons, Jonathan's age was 6 and Suzanne was of 7 years old, went on a voyage for their ship in July 1976. They started from Plymouth, England. They wanted to complete the sea trip around the world, just like the one that had been completed 200 years ago by the famous Captain James Cook. The narrator and his wife spent 16 years improving their skills. They got a ship built professionally, a 23-meter long, 30-ton heavy wooden hull called Wave Walker. They took several months to test it in the roughest of weathers. Now look at the second paragraph. The first leg of our planned 3-year well lakh 50,000 kilometer 5,000 kilometer, not 50,000, 1,05,000 kilometer journey passed pleasantly as we sailed down the west coast of Africa to Cape Town. There, before heading east, we took on two crew men, American Larry Wiesel and Swiss Herb Seisler, to help us tackle one of the world's roughest seas, the Southern Indian Ocean. So the first phase of their long journey of 1,05,000 kilometer passed pleasantly. They sailed down the west coast to west coast of Africa to Cape Town. The narrator hired two crewmen before heading towards the east and to tackle the roughest sea, the Southern Indian ocean. On the second day out of Cape Town, we began to encounter strong gales. Gales means a very strong wind. For the next few weeks, they blew continuously. Gales did not worry me, but the size of the waves was alarming, up to 15 meters, as high as our main mast. Mast is a part of ship. It is a tall upright structure on a boat or ship. So the picture of boat is given in your textbook. So there is a picture of a ship, and also has been described each part indicated. The writer has each part of ship. So there you can see the mast of the ship. Okay. So in this paragraph, the narrator tells us that after, you know, hiring Larry Wiesel, which was an American, and Herb Seisler, which was a Swiss. So on the second day in Cape Town, they encountered a strong wind which continued for several weeks. A strong wind was not a problem. The strong wind was not a problem. The problem was the wind's height. It was 15 meters high waves. The reason of their problem was the 15 meters high waves, which were the height of the mast. It worried the narrator. So, because the size of the waves was alarming, it was up to 15 meters high. So, it worried the narrator. Look at the next paragraph. December 25 found us 3,500 kilometers east of Cape Town. Despite atrocious weather, we had atrocious means bad of bad weather or very poor or very poor quality. Okay, so December 25 December 25 they had traveled 35 kilometers east of Cape Town. Despite of atrocious weather, we had a wonderful holiday, completed with a Christmas tree. New Year's Day saw no improvement in the weather, but we reasoned that it had to change soon, and it did for the worse. So on December 25 they had traveled 35 kilometers east of Cape Town. They celebrated Christmas together despite of bad weather. The weather remained the same till New Year's Day, but they hoped for it to change soon. The weather condition worsened. So narrator thought that it would change soon, and it changed, but it worsened. Okay, it did not improve. At the dawn on January 2, the waves were gigantic. Gigantic means huge, of a big size. We were sailing with only a small storm jib. Storm jib also a part of ship, a part of boat, a triangular stay sail set forward the mast in a ship. So it's also like mast, it's also a part of ship. which set forward the mast in a ship. Okay, so in that picture you can also see this part of ship. Okay, and were still making 8 knots. So knots, a unit of speed equal to 1 nautical mile per hour. Okay, used specially of ship, aircraft or winds. So it is used to measure the speed. And were still making 8 knots as the ship rose to the top of each wave. We could see endless enormous seas rolling towards us, and the screaming of the wind and spray was painful to the ears. To slow the boat down, we dropped the storm jib and lashed means to hit with a lot of force, and lashed a heavy mooring means ropes or chains in a loop, which is a rope type of thing which is used to join the rope, to tie the rope. Okay, a type of chain, okay, which is used to attach the rope. Across the stern, then we double lashed everything, went through our life raft drill attached, lifeline donned means put on board, oil skins and life jackets, and waited. So what did the narrator do then, when the weather condition was sent? Okay. So on the early morning of January 2nd, the waves were very huge. They were sailing with a small storm jib at a speed of 8 knots. When the ship was sailing with the huge waves, they could see the huge sea in front of them. The noise of the waves and strong winds was painful for the ears. They dropped the storm jib to slow down the ship and hit a heavy mooring rope across the back part of the ship in a loop. They lashed everything with double force. Okay, so they lashed everything with double force. They put on their oilskins. They wore their oilskins and life jackets, attached lifelines, and went through the life raft drills and waited. So now the weather was worsened. So they took all the precautionary measures. So now they were ready for the dangerous weather, and the weather was becoming danger day by day. Look at the next paragraph. The first indication of impending disaster came at around 6 p.m. with an ominous silence. So impending means about to happen. So the first indication of impending disaster came at about 6 p.m. with an ominous silence. Ominous silence means unpleasant or threatening silence. The wind dropped and the sky immediately grew dark. Then came a growing roar and an enormous cloud toward aft. Aft means, you know, near the stern of the ship. So towards aft of the ship. With horror, I realized that it was not a cloud, but a wave like no other I had ever seen. It appeared perfectly vertical and almost twice the height of the other waves, with a frightful, very dangerous, very shocking breaking crest. So breaking crest, reaching the top of the wave. So what happened about 6 p.m.? So around 6 p.m. an unpleasant silence rolled over. It was an indication of a disaster which was about to happen. The wind suddenly dropped and the sky was darker with heavy clouds. A huge cloud was coming towards the stern of the ship. But later the narrator realized that it was a huge wave. The wave was perfectly vertical and it was twice the height of the previous waves. They saw with the top of the wave looking unpleasant due to its height. So it was very unpleasant and shocking. Look at the next paragraph. The roar increased to a thunder as the stern moved up the face of the wave, and for a moment I thought we might ride over it. But then tremendous explosion shook the deck. A torrent of green, so deck also part of ship, it is floor. The deck means floor of ship. A torrent means, you know, stream of water, current of water, moving stream of water means current of water. So a torrent of green and white water broke over the ship. My head smashed into the wheel and I was aware of flying overboard and sinking below the waves. I accepted my approaching death, and as I was losing as the narrator was losing consciousness, I felt quite peaceful. So here the weather became, it was the roughest weather. The thunder increased and the waved move the stern up. They thought that it would not do any damage, but a huge explosion vibrated the deck. A strong moving stream of green and white water broke over the ship. The narrator's head, you know, shattered or violently broken in the wheel of the ship. He flew overboard and sank below the waves. He accepted that his death was approaching and started losing consciousness. He felt very peaceful. So now the narrator felt that his death was approaching. He was in very critical condition. So it was the roughest weather now. okay, and they had to sail through the roughest weather. The waves were very high, so it was very challenging for the narrator as well as his family. So look at the graph. Unexpectedly, my head popped out of water. So as his head came out from water. A few meters away, wave walker was near capsizing, her mast almost horizontal. Then capsizing means be overturned in the water. So then a wave hurled means, you know, throw with a great force her upright. My lifeline jerked out. Tout means, you know, stretched or became tight, pulled tightly. I grabbed the guard rails and sailed through the air into wave walker's main boom. Boom means pole that controls the angle and shape of the sail. They are all part of a ship. Subsequent waves tossed me around the deck like a rag doll. My left ribs cracked, my mouth filled with blood and broken teeth. Somehow I found the wheel, lined up and stunned for the next wave and hang on. So what happened in this paragraph? The narrator's head popped out of water, came out of water. The ship was about to overturn, but a wave turned her upright. His lifeline jacket was stretched. He grabbed the guard rails and sailed to the ship's main pole. The waves tossed him around the deck. He was injured as his left ribs cracked, his mouth filled with blood, and he had a broken tooth. He found the wheel, lined the stern for the next wave and waited. Next, look at the next paragraph. Water everywhere. I could feel that the ship had water below, but I dared not abandon the wheel to investigate. Suddenly, the front hatch was thrown open and Mary appeared. We are sinking. She scrammed. The decks are smashed. We are full of water. Take the wheel. I shouted and I scrambled, you know, climb, okay, for the hatch, for the door. So what happened in this paragraph? There was water everywhere. The narrator could feel water below the ship, but did not leave the wheel alone. Suddenly, the front door opened and his wife Mary came screaming that they were sinking. She said, "The decks are smashed. We are full of water." The narrator handed her the wheel and climbed towards the door. Okay, so in this class, till this paragraph, in the next class, In my next video, I will explain the next part of this chapter, this interesting chapter. So keep revising, okay? And keep watching all the videos. Thank you for watching the video.